love mean to you? Any responses? What does love mean to you?
Everything. Okay.
JJ?
Caring for people.
Yes. Anyone else?
We're quiet this morning.
Okay, so I have another question for you, Ben. Where's the first place you would look for a definition of love? Dictionary? Bible?
Google.
Where?
Your heart.
Your heart. Whoa, I like
that one. Yeah.
Well, sorry, for those of you that would first look in the dictionary, I agree with those who would first look in the Bible. God is the author of love. And so that's where, as a pastor, I'm going to look for a definition of love, because I want to get that definition directly from the Creator. God describes love as having very special qualities, and one of them is slow to anger. Paul elaborates on the qualities of love as being patient and kind, never jealous, boastful or rude, never insisting in its own way, never rude or haughty or proud. It is not irritable or resentful. I really love this definition of love, right? It gives it all to us, right? It does not rejoice in wrong, but rejoices at right. It bears all things and endures all things. Love is even greater than hope, prophecy, and faith. Paul elaborates on how we as Christians should love one another. God describes how we should love him by keeping his commandments. And God doesn't just tell us this one time. He tells us again, over and over, to make sure that we don't miss it. God tells us in Exodus 20, chapter 20, verse 6, I, referring to God, will show love to those who love me and keep my commandments. God tells us again in Deuteronomy 5:10, I, meaning God, will show steadfast love to thousands who love me and keep my commandments. God tells us again in Deuteronomy 7:9, those who love me will keep my commandments. God's nature is described to us in Exodus 34:6. God is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Steadfast means that God's love for us never ends. It means that God's love for us endures all things. God's love endures for us even when we fall short of his requirements. Even when we mess up. When we look at God's people, we see incredible acts of faithfulness and love, as recorded in Genesis 22, where Abraham's love for God was so great, he was ready to sacrifice his only son Isaac until God provided the lamb that got caught in the bushes. Levitical law tells us that we are to love our neighbor as ourselves. It goes on to tell us that the stranger who sojourns with us should also be to us as the native among us, and we should love him or her as ourselves. I believe there are various levels of love. For example, the love one has for a pet rabbit, or a hamster, or a bird, or a goldfish is very different than the love one would have for a human being. The love you have for a friend is very different than the love you have for a spouse. The love you have for a parent is very different than the love you have for your spouse or a friend. And the Greeks, I know I've said this before, but in case you didn't catch it or need to be reminded or didn't hear it before, the Greeks chose three different words for love so that it would be clear what kind of love they were speaking about. So philos was used to explain what brotherly love would have been. It is used to describe the kind of bond among friends
and family members.
Eros was used to describe the kind of love you would have for an intimate partner. Agape is the perfect love that originates from God and is the characteristic of God. This love is unconditional. It is a love that always forgives, not even just 70 times 7, always forgives and endures with patience through any hardship or attacks from outside influences. This agape love cannot be shaken or altered. It is at the heart of God that we as humans would experience His unconditional agape love in all the fullness that it is. This love can be experienced by the human through the spirit and the soul only by being united and joined together spiritually through Christ. For Jesus Christ is the expression of God the Father's agape love to the world. Philos is imperfect when placed in comparison to agape love. Philos can have limitations and conditions that have the ability to break the love, and this is seen in too many relationships that have been broken because of hurt and unforgiveness. Philos is not perfect because it can be shattered. It is not absolutely necessary to know agape love to experience philos love. In fact, many people in all types of relationships are experiencing a degree of philos love, and because it has limitations, there will be different degrees of philos expressions that can exist. So when we look at the three loves and we look at Eros, we can look at Eros as a temporary kind of love that can stand on its own. Eros can be expressed with or without a marriage commitment and will only last as long as the erotic attraction has strength to support it. So Eros is generally based upon physical attractions in most cases, but can also be an expression of philos that has developed. In truth, if philos has not been developed, then Eros will not have the same depth of experience. Eros without first developing philos is always an expression of a person's own desires and needs and is acted upon in a selfish manner that seeks to gratify a lust. In order for a relationship to be sustained and become fully blessed by God, agape love must be the foundation that supports philos, which will lead to the great experience of Eros. So if you're picturing this three kinds of love, if you picture a triangle that would be cut horizontally into three levels and was sitting with the peak at the top, then the perfect relationship would function with agape love at the foundation of the triangle. Philos would be the midsection and Eros would be the peak. If a relationship is being attempted to be built upon the peak of Eros and not the foundation of agape, then it will topple over sooner or later. Have you ever been in a relationship that is one-sided? I think most of us have been in a relationship that is one-sided, where the person that you love does not love you back in the same way. Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments. Jesus loves each one of us, but do we love him back in the same amount of love, agape love? Truly loving another goes way beyond philos. To really reach agape love involves sacrifice. That's the key. I can tell you that my dad loved my mom so much by sending her a dozen roses every Valentine's Day. But that is the type of romantic love. He brought home his paycheck every Sunday, every week, so that there would be food on the table and a roof over our heads. And that was his love for us as a provider. But the truest test of love was a love that included his very own sacrifice. The love that we promised during our marriage vows, in sickness and in health, not just when things are going well. That true test is when someone gets dementia or Alzheimer's and their spouse continues to love them the same way they love them on the day of their vows, but even more. With a sacrificial love that knows no bounds, a love that stood strong amongst trials, struggles, and hardships. Sacrifice doesn't have to be so drastic. It can simply be going to a movie that you particularly didn't want to see when you really wanted to go to a ball game instead, just to make the other person happy. Or going for Chinese food because it's the other person's favorite instead of going for Italian, which is your favorite. Love is a basic foundational need for all human beings. Classic psychology, and I probably shared this with you once before, demonstrated two newborn monkeys, and they placed each one in a separate room. And one was given just a bottle of milk, and the other one was just given a surrogate mother. The one that was only given nourishment died. The one that was given love lived. I know from counseling individuals that it is painful to never have heard from a parent that they are loved by them. There are girls and guys looking for love and sometimes in the wrong places. One of my high school youth group members from many years ago wanted to commit suicide after he lost his first love. Imperfect love is prevalent in our society. It makes the headlines of a multitude of magazines and news stories. But perfect love is found in the one who created us. God provides us. It's kind of like the Holy Spirit working through the anthem that Sue chose this morning. God provides us with flowers in the springtime. He gives us fish, animals, birds, vegetables, fruits, and nuts for food. He gives us the cocoa bean from which we make chocolate. And the coffee bean, which some people just can't do without. Most mornings he paints the sky with his hand. He sends tropical breezes to the South Pacific Islands. He created mountains for us to climb. How much do we show him our gratitude? How much do we show him that we really love him? Is our level of love for him on fire? Are we enthusiastic about sharing Jesus' love with others? Do we hunger and thirst for his word? Do we spend time in daily devotion? Do we meditate on the scriptures? Do we talk about Jesus like he's our best friend or a distant relative? What's our level of commitment to his house of worship? For most of us here today, it is very high. But there are a growing number of people who are against us as Christians. Confessing atheists are challenging our very right as Christians. I don't know if you've heard this before, but one atheistic group was actually successful in getting the Air Force to scratch Bibles off the list of on-base requirements for lodging rooms. That means that atheists can go around throwing the Bibles away that the Gideons have placed there, and there's nothing Christians can do about it. I heard on the news yesterday that in California, they are trying to pass a law that would make the Bible illegal to read or to sell. It's scary. We need to be fervent. Loving God means that we keep his commandments. Loving God means that our love for God grows stronger with time. Loving God means that we love reading our Bibles with others. Loving God means that we love praying together. Loving God means that we love worshiping together with others. Loving God means that we love our enemies and we welcome the stranger. God's greatest gift that he has given to us is love. The ability to share love and to receive love. It's extremely important to never take that love for granted. Let us always multiply that love, share that love, and welcome that love in Jesus' name.